meet an expat in Hong Kong one night.
And that's the best part.
And then we ended up having a night very similar to Josh and Ruby's, where we met through mutual friends, and we went out to sing karaoke until like 6 a.m. in the morning, and I thought we were forming a connection, but then at the end of the night, I find out that he has a girlfriend. So that's sort of like how, that's like the impetus of this whole sort of project. I was like, oh, so that's what the story's going to be. It's going to be like two people forming a connection, and then it's the wrong time.
First time I'm hearing that story. That's why it feels real. I think some people can connect with that. Yeah.
You also created Justin Bieber.
Oh, right. And so Ruby's job, I'm also a toy designer by day. I did create moves like Jagger and Justin Bieber, and you can purchase them online.
This is okay. I put to buy a bicycle.
Bryan, I'm going to turn to you because you've worked with Emily before, so I was curious to hear about about your work partnership.
Right. Emily and I worked on two films where Emily was a producer, and we already had a great relationship, and a great working relationship, which is so important when, as an actor, you need to trust your director, and I asked her at the premiere of The Kitchen, this film we did, what are you working on? She's like, well, I got this script, and it's about an expat and an Asian American who meet in Hong Kong. And I'm like, well, that sounds cool. Did you know that I'm dating Jamie Chung? She's like, I did not. She's like, well, you guys should read this script. So we read the script out loud, and there were so many similarities to our own life and just how timing works, and we loved the dialogue, we fell in love with the story, and we called her, we're like, we're in. Is that easy?
What kind of preparations did you have for the movie? I mean, I really like your portrayals of both characters. You're playing this bank. Did you hang out with the local Australian bankers? You say anything specific that you did? You also speak a bit of Cantonese in it.
Yeah, I hope I didn't botch that too bad. The person who taught me Cantonese was Scottish, so I think I only Cantonese. I think the hardest part for us was, because we already had an off-screen chemistry, was to unknow each other. And so Jamie had the brilliant idea of getting two hotel rooms, which I didn't really agree with. What are you gonna do?
What about you, Jamie? How did you connect with the character? How did you build this character of Ruby? I imagine you must have had many conversations with him.
Yeah, there were so many similarities. I am Korean American, and the first time that I went back to Korea, I certainly felt like a fish out of water. It was so fun to play the tourist, and it's so easy. Like, the first time being in Hong Kong, and it was just the discovery. So when I'm looking around, like, that really was, like, the first time I was looking around. For real. I mean, we did rehearsals and whatnot, but to literally plan out physically how long one scene would take, like, how many streets. But I was trying not to enjoy myself then, because I really wanted it to be, wonderful the first time really discovering it.
Was it difficult to play with your real-life fiancé and distanciate yourself from that?
Was it hard?
Is that a trick question? No, it's great. Like, I mean, we work on each other's scenes all the time at home for other projects, and I think, personally, I was really excited to work with Jamie because she doesn't get to play these kind of roles, usually, these romantic movies. She's always doing these action movies, which is the movies that I never get to do. So. But I was really just so happy that she had a chance to play this great role, and I thought it was easy. I don't know. What do you think?
I mean, certainly, like, after a 12-hour shooting day, you're like, all right, bye. We'll go to our separate rooms. Yeah. And that helped, I think.
Okay. What about shooting in Hong Kong? So I think Hong Kong is has its good sides and bad sides in terms of shooting.
Yeah, I mean, like, making your first film is already challenging, and then to make your film in a foreign country, like, has a whole different sense of challenges. So we had permits to shoot all over Hong Kong, but we didn't have the budget, obviously, to block off any streets. So everything, like all the extras that you guys saw on screen, they're just real people of Hong Kong. Like we basically just showed up, and I threw my two actors into the busiest streets of Hong Kong, and it's like, okay, go and do your scene. And like for a lot of them, we would like hide, like the camera crew would hide across the streets using a long lens, and they were locked. We didn't have the boom out, so a lot of times people would just like passing by and not even realize they were doing a scene. But that's exactly what I wanted. It's like I want to capture these two people in this really realistic, busy metropolis. Because if you know, if you've been to Hong Kong, it's like Times Square times 100. Like that's how crazy it is. But on certain other sequences, where you know we have a lot of these walk, like really long walk and talk sequences, they're all done by Steadicam, and it's, you know, 4 or 5 uninterrupted minutes. You know, and like we would do these really long takes, and everything would go beautifully for the first like third or fourth minute. Like the performances are great, and like the camera work is great. And then out of nowhere, you'll have a drunken expat that, you know, like comes behind, and is like, "Hey, mom," or like say hi to the camera, like, or tell us to get off their street, or yell at us, and then we gotta like start all over and do it again.
Yeah.
So I would probably say the drunken expat.
Yeah, it was only the expats. The locals were cool. The drunken expats were assholes.
Yeah, they were the biggest challenge. And then the weather also was, it was just, Bryan, maybe you could tell them how hot it was.
Hot. Yeah, this is not the kind of film where we had dressing rooms or anything like that. So we literally had a van that would wait, it was on, and the air conditioning would be running, and we'd shoot the scene, we'd run into the van, cool off, go around the block, and then come back. That's kind of how we stayed without having wet armpits throughout the
Nice. Was that the first time you were shooting Hong Kong as well? That was the first time for you, Jamie?
Yeah, I've never been.
And
yes.
Was that you, Ryan?
First time.
So. I want to ask all of you before turning to the audience about, I want to ask you about the Linklater influence. Of course, were you familiar with the Before trilogy? Is that something that you watched, or did you try not to watch it if you had not to be influenced?
I hadn't watched them until we signed on to do this, and she's like, "You should probably watch this."
I did not watch it because I didn't love them. I know, but I felt like I wanted to separate the originals with this one because it was much more personal to me personally. Reading the stories, I had so much to relate to it, but so I couldn't even get through the first one.
Well, I think they're very similar, you know, in genre, but I feel like this movie is a little more grounded. Whereas those movies, they talk about these like esoteric philosophies and, you know, these conversations, they, I don't know, just what I responded to this movie was the dialogue and how real it was. And I think that's what sets this film apart.
Yeah, like I keep getting this question over and over, and I think every single review we've ever had, they reference Before Sunrise. And the thing is, like, the Before movies are truly one of my favorite movies of all time, so it's a very, you know, it's like you want to make a movie that you want to see. And I think Linklater invented the walk and talk romance genre, and he did it first and he did it best. But I feel like there's room, you know, in cinema to make more than just one walk and talk romance. Like, I think it would be really sad if, because he did it so well and he did it first, that we are not allowed to make a story about Ruby and Josh in Hong Kong. You know, but I definitely, you know, Bernie did it to Linklater because he invented this genre. But I feel like, yeah, like I said, you know, the conversations are very different. They're based a lot on my personal experiences. You know, like Jesse and Celine, they're just a little bit more philosophical, and they're not how I talk. So, you know, like with the characters I created, they talk about things I like to talk about, like Facebook. You know, that's the kind of person I am. So.
Thanks.